by watching the replays, watching Honcast, watching the top teams, emulating. I'm serious,
Oh,
emulating
yeah,
what the
of
top
course, yeah.
teams do, and that's how you get better. Is you know pointing out your mistakes or finding your mistakes and you know deciding how to improve on those. Watching
Yeah.
replays, watching the top level teams. What do they do differently that we don't do?
Listening to Trough.
Listening to me. Listening for my trout. My seal
Stamp
of
of
approval.
approval or seal of approval, of
When I give
course.
that, you know that the team is doing something exceptionally well.
Yes, that's when you know things are going very, very good. No, but you're right, though. On a more serious note, you're definitely right. And it's something that I'm sure a lot of these teams, again, not only they already have kind of experienced that, but they're going to continue to experience that. With that said, though, ladies and gentlemen, it looks like both teams are officially ready to go. And in fact, both teams have already readied up. And, well, we're already at the blind band stage. So, Trough, are you ready to kick off another great weekend here?
I'm more than ready today.
I am too. Hopefully you guys are. We have game number one here of this best of the three Midget Mafia reunion, taking on the big boys. Game number one. All right, so as you can see, I promised you and I delivered. Thank you, me. We are at the banning stage here, of course, or the blind ban stage for that matter, between Big Boys and Midget Mafia Reunion. It is a case of, unfortunately, neither team is too tagged up, and you know my pet peeve on that. And, you know, I just wish teams would take the time to, you know, sign up for a clan and tag themselves up. But hey, you know, you don't have to, it's not required.
Right.
To each their own. But. Yeah, so we see right here, you know, some of the players that we talked about, Tomkiss and Hicks over there, and you mentioned Rookie over there for the Hellborn team. So some names that at least we recognize and expecting a decent matchup. The blind ban's taking place. We have Wild Soul and Silhouette for our Legion side. Parasite and Pebbles taken care of by the big boys.
Yeah, a Wild Soul, of course, is a hero that's so popular in the metagame right now for reasons being that he can go in that suicide role and still do successfully against one hero, against two hero, even against three or two heroes, even against three heroes, because he can pull the lane with his bear and get you know
Yeah.
proper lane positioning. He can also, once he hits level three, he has that level, he has that entangle up on his bear, and you can actually man up on certain heroes. But also, as we I'll talk a little bit more about the blind bans. Fade was left unbanned right now, and is locked quickly as the first lock from Tomkiss, and that is a hero. I was mentioning, I was actually streaming last night, and I was mentioning the two heroes I feel like are the strongest in the metagame right now, hands down, are Fade and Wild Soul.
Yeah.
And so being in the first position, the Midget Mafia reunion is going to be hard to say all the time, but they quickly lock that. And actually, look at those interesting locks coming out from Hellborn as they go Flint and Arachna. Now, I wouldn't really call those trollish locks; they're different. But I think that I think they're both viable. You just have to find a way to kind of fit them in. Properly, it's difficult, but
Yeah.
they're workable.
Yeah, well, it really comes down to a case of they're workable, but it's like we talk about all the time. There just simply are better options out there, it seems like. You know, you got Draconis, you got Forsaken Archer. If you're looking for ranged carries, it seems like those would be the more go-to. Now, on the other note, of course, I love seeing stuff like that, so I'm kind of playing devil's advocate with myself here even. But I love seeing that because, you know, Flint Beastwood is a hero that we never get to see on the competitive scene anymore. And it's always
Yeah.
fun, of course, seeing new heroes on the competitive scene. But from a realistic point of view, you know, there's reasons why certain heroes are picked up. And you got to question that a little bit, but we'll see. And I also do wonder, you know, as you've talked about, this is we give them this title of this Pub All-Stars team even over here on the Hellborn side and the big boys. But you got to wonder a little bit, you know, a TMM is a different game
Oh, yeah.
than competitive Heroes of New Earth, at least on the tournament level. So obviously, you know, where heroes like Nomad even could be so successful in TMN. I know your thoughts on Nomad and how, well, he just doesn't really seem to fit at all in the competitive scene. So you got to wonder how that's going to play a role here in a matchup like this.
I do think Nomad, the change to Nomad has helped him a little bit.
Yeah.
I think he might be workable in some situations. It's just a little bit like a lot of different heroes are viable, but the problem is just lockpick in general. It's you don't want to get screwed over. Like you don't want to be left with certain heroes and you're like, oh no, now I have to tri lane with Arachna on support. Like you don't want to be caught in that position. I've seen teams get in the position of, oh, we got Pebbles, awesome, but oh god, now we can't. Now we have to tri lane like Pebbles, Aluna, Forsaken Archer. So, oh no, like you don't want to
Yeah.
get caught in that. That's the problem. So when you lock heroes like Flint. And you want to run them, you have to make sure that you have your lanes set up accordingly so that you actually can have favorable lanes.
Yeah. Well, the locking pool is overall finished. It started with the Fade, as we talked about, then the Arachna Flint, followed by Aluna Pyromancer, and then Plague Rider, actually going to be the final lock coming out for the big boys, aka Dirty Mobs over there. who, of course, is the captain for his team. So the banning phase now beginning. We got Jerziah right away going to be banned by Tom Kiss. Again, Tom Kiss, a.k.a. Russ Agent 007. For those that know that name throughout Han's competitive history, he's been around for a while. It's good to see him back on the scene. Nymphora going to be banned right there by Boy over here on the Hellborn side. So going to kind of go through the banning phase here, see some interesting bans perhaps. But then, of course, start with the actual picking phase. And that's always the fun part. But again, you keep talking about how a lot of experience is going to come from these matches. But over time as well, you know, I'm sure with just so many, the sheer amount of teams that are in such an event like this and how many matches are happening week in and week out, I mean, you're bound to see different things. You're bound to see perhaps even shifts in the meta game as a result of just so many teams finding out different things about it. So, again, I'm really intrigued to see if that's something we start to see as this Han Tour qualifiers move on, let alone the first cycle of the event, of course. But Mage Ban and Dark Lead are going to be the follow-up, so some carries being put in there in the banning phase.
Yeah, Jerziah and M4, Mage Ban, Dark Lady. There's still a lot of different things you can run as far as a carry goes. You know, we've seen Monkey King. We've seen, obviously, Draconis many times. Two more bans left to go. One ban on each side. Tom Kiss, what does he want to do? Now, if he's locking that Fade, of course, in that lock pick, that would tell me that he wants to take that no matter what. So you need to set up your lanes accordingly. Do you want your Fade to be solo mid? If so, you know, we need to make sure we get a dual lane bottom. Well, if we pick Fade, they're most likely going to take a Luna, so priority should be maybe on a support.
Yeah.
So there's all these things that you got to think about. They do go ahead and ban out that Tempest, so they don't want to give him that strong jungler. Another thing I haven't noted, too, is that in the metagame right now, Keeper of the Forest is so strong, obviously with that the ability to be able to suicide with 12 armor from your max Nature's Veil. And, well, speaking of the devil, he does get banned. So actually, looking at other things that are left open that are powerhouses, I'm looking at Bubbles, I'm looking at Tundra as well. So the thing about Tundra, though, is if you want to play Fade, that kind of makes your lanes a little bit iffy. That almost tells me Suicide Tundras. And if you, it can't work, actually. Suicide Tundra is actually quite strong, but I don't know.
Yeah, it's not the maximized use of the hero. But at the same time, I mean, having a Tundra with a hero like Fade even, I mean, it could be great in the sense of you scout it with the Shiver initially. Of course, with Fade, with her ultimate, she doesn't even necessarily need that. She kind of just runs around with that clear vision, or not the clear vision, but with the vision around her, being able to run through the trees and whatnot. So, we'll see what the options are here coming out for our Legion team. So you see Tom Kiss, he's currently right-clicking that bubble, so perhaps that's a hero that he's interested in picking up to kick off here. So, and sure enough, Bubbles is going to be the first pick coming out for Midget Mafia Reunion here on the Legion side. So we'll see what the two responses are from Boy's side. I'm still waiting for these, of course, we've seen a bit of profit. But the other 5 heroes to maybe start being picked up for some things about Bramble, Ravenor perhaps. Prophet, that is a hero that we kind of guessed, and sure enough, as we saw right from the beginning, really, he seems to have a place in the competitive scene. So,
to see him. Prophet's pretty strong. Tundra is picked up. I was going to call both those picks exactly. I know that this team is actually a team that loves to run Draconis, and hey, with Dark Lady, Silhouette, and Magebane banned, and Draconis still on the board, why not pick him up? So they pick him up. They also pick up Tundra. They have a very strong solo mid. They have a very strong solo short. If they want to solo him short, they can also, I expect them to pick up that Luna, assuming that Fade is going to get first picked out of that lockpick phase. And then, whoa, there's the Alonia. Alonia is actually a hero. I don't really know what he does, but oh my god, does she do a lot of damage. That's all I know.
I'm on the same boat as you. I have played her maybe twice in Mid Wars, but still, I'm just a little bit, I'm not confident in exactly calling out, you know, how exactly she's supposed to be played. And so you know what? This is going to be a case of both you and I, and I'm sure the community out there, hey, we're going to get an idea of what Alonia is going to bring to the table. I'm also a little bit in between on, because I've heard different things, whether or not she's more of a support style hero, or even if she's more of a solo style hero, kind of like your Hag, or your Bubbles even, or your Bombardier.
Right.
Kinesis. I don't think she's necessarily like suicide potential, but definitely solo mid is something I'm sure we could see out of her. So, I'm intrigued, though. So, kind of going with exactly what I was talking about, these 6 new heroes being released, I'm looking forward to start seeing more of them. Sure enough, we got Alonia and then Glacius. So, double freeze coming out here on the Legion side. Ophelia is going to be the final pick, though, for the big boys, and I must say, that's a strong lineup over there.
It must be too early in the morning for me or something, because I didn't even see Ophelia.
Yeah.
I'm just so caught up in all the other different things that are happening.
Yeah, 1:15 in the afternoon.
I know, it's way too early. Guys, but Ophelia, very, very strong. Of course, it is going up against the Glacius. There's that Fade pick out of that lock pool. Very standard right there. I just expected that. And they have a number of now carries to choose from. They can go Arachna, not the strongest. I feel like Flint actually would be the best.
I mean,
the
they have Draconis,
here.
Though.
No, oh, and I'm talking about...
Oh, okay. I was like, yeah, that would be interesting.
We're probably going to see right here a Luna Plague.
Luna Plague, yeah. That's a, yeah. You think a Luna, Draconis, Tundra mid, and then Plague Suicide.
Yep.
Yeah, that. I mean, God, that is such a powerful lineup right there. So, yeah, they got the jungle. That's, you know, your... Wouldn't that be a god-tier lineup, would you say?
It's pretty strong.
Much, yeah.
It's pretty strong.
That could definitely be there. So, obviously, they're going to think about it. They still have 10 seconds to go here with the leftover time. But, oh, actually, Aluna Pyromancer.
Okay.
Final two picks. A little bit of a switch up there, but that leads me to believe that we're probably going to see a Tundra Suicide.
I think Tundra Suicide would be great. I fear that they're actually going to try Lane Draconis. I don't think they need to, but if they do, that would mean, well... Yeah, I'm not quite sure. No, they can't. They can't try Lane Draconis. That would be stupid. But
that'd be Ophelia mid.
Ophelia's solo mid, which can be
hey,
done.
That W, Q and W. Who needs creeps? You just max out Q and W. You get Codex.
What you do is you just get
bursting people.
You just get one into your creep, and then you go take over a creep. You have like a Minotaur sitting behind mid, and then you harass them. They don't even expect it because they're like, "Wait, you're solo mid. Why did you get a creep?"
Yeah.
Yeah. Hacks. and then they scream hacks.
They.
Yep.
All right, so going to be loading into the game here, but yeah, that would be interesting. We're probably not going to see that. Flint Beastwood, though, the final pick over here.
Yep.
By the Midget Mafia Reunion. So Tom Kiss, again, a.k.a. Russ Agent 007, he's going to be the one playing Flint Beastwood. And again, Flint's a hero. He had his prime time on the competitive scene. He used to be the go-to carry pickup for a while there on the competitive scene. So it's not like he's bad by any means, but as you were saying... And, you know, as I was kind of talking about, it just seems like there's better options out there, but he can bring his own to the table, so can't wait to see what he does. Is it safe to say that, I don't know, what do you think? Is it going to be the harder carry than a Draconis?
I think so, honestly. That might seem very, very silly, but, I mean, Draconis farms way quicker. That's the power of Draconis. It's the ability to get those items up very fast. Are we going to see a level 1 Congo, or they're just
coming
down
here to
scout? Yeah, that'd be pretty silly. I've seen Sittler, though. I mean, you can actually do it with Pyro if you do level up that passive, but obviously doesn't have that. They're just roaming down here in the jungle. They want to find somebody. They might actually be successful. Here's a fade down here. It's going to be a support fade, actually. And he sees him. He actually spots him out, so lucky for him. He knows that all 5 members of the Hellboard team are in that jungle trying to find something, but he's going to back off. We're going to see, it looks like, a tri-lane, straight-up tri-lane, Flint, Fade, and Glacius. So, of course, yeah, like I said, Fade is going to be playing that support role. A Suicide Bubbles, obviously. And then, of course, that solo mid Alonia using that new skin. That's a pretty cool skin, I got to say.
Ooh, yeah, it is actually.
Really
it's
neat
like
skin.
It reminds me a little bit of Sub-Zero. It's like a female Sub-Zero almost.
They have a lot of ice here in the Legion team.
I know. That's what I'll say. Glacius, Alonia.
Yeah.
Well, I guess that's it, but.
That's a lot of ice.
Hey, that's a lot of ice. Man. I can't wait for Alonia. Talk about Alonia. I mean, she's going for a quick bottle build, obviously. She goes the 1 mark of Novice, a Minor Totem, and a Health Potion. So has 300 gold still from the start. So, of course, needs that 600 for the bottle. But she will be well on her way. But, yeah, can't wait to see Albin Agent here. No, that's not who. Whore is actually playing Alonia here for the Legion team. So it's going to be interesting to see how that works out. The Hellborn side, they kind of respond to this tri-lane with a pseudo tri-lane of their own, actually. Pyromancer, Aluna, and then, of course, Ophelia playing aggressive in the jungle. So,
my God.
So what do you make of this setup?
Yeah, there's so much burst.
Oh,
my God. Yeah, now the good thing is they do have Glacius down here to fend off some of the ganks coming out from Ophelia. Obviously, you can use that Ice Imprisonment to stop the creeps, but actually did level up that Glacial Blast first, and a lot of aggression early on onto Pyromancer with those long range, and Flint is long range as well. Obviously, he doesn't have his, what is that called, the Dead Eye yet, but has a little bit of spam from Explosive Flare. So right now, they're going to lose a little bit of lane control. No, it's not too bad right now, but Ophelia is going to be the difference maker right here. Has an early Skeleton King, which has actually been buffed since the past.
Oh, we see actually Tundra says, you got burst, I got burst too. Goes in right there on Alonia with a cold shoulder and actually does a decent amount of damage. So Alonia needs to be a little bit careful about that, but by all means, not going to expect any kills to happen. There we go with the 600 gold though, so she already has a bottle being delivered on the way. So like I said, going for the early bottle, and while gets it just over the minute mark, that's a pretty damn fast bottle. So, and Alonia seems like that kind of hero that she will gladly spam her abilities, especially with this Q, what's called the Glacial Spike actually. Which is that, of course, kind of like that that almost Sonic Boom style of ability with ice that just flies through the air and just constant damage in an AoE radius. So, and of course, when she starts leveling up her W, I believe it is, that passive, it actually starts to add charges. And the more charges, actually, the more slow that ability will do for her, it seems like. So, kind of just quickly reading the tooltips and understanding the hero right here with everyone else. But yeah, excited to see what Horror brings to the table here playing this Alonia. She does level up her Flash Freeze ability on top of that, so... Again, we'll see what that brings to the table, but so far, speaking of matchups here, Alonia's 8-1, Tundra's 10-3 though, so Tundra's actually doing a very solid job here of holding his own.
Oh, well, yeah, I mean, Tundra's got so much, you know, so many good stats starting out early, and it's going to actually look to get a haste rune down here, could maybe set something up here in the bottom. The only problem is when you do try to gank, he is going to try, no, he's just going to go back mid. Okay, I was going to say, the only problem when you try to gank is if you're unsuccessful, you really lose a lot of farming experience compared to the other mid here solo that's just, you know, getting all that farming experience. So, yeah, I'm not surprised that Tundra's doing well. I mean, at the same time, I'm actually a little surprised that Alonia's doing as well as she is. I don't know exactly what that hero does, but it does have spam capabilities. I'm sure that's very good against a melee hero, but Tundra is one of the strongest melee heroes.
Oh,
in the game.
Bottom lane, Pyromancer in a lot of trouble, missing the Dragon Fire. Oh, it does hit Glacius. Is that going to be enough to save? Couple more auto attacks from Flint. Flint needs to be careful not to dive too much. He's going to turn around, and Pyromancer will survive. So, very close exchange right there. But in the end, both do stay alive. Alonia running into the Minotaur right here, controlled by Ophelia, of course. Not going to be able to finish it off, though. The uphill attack actually missing, and the Minotaur will stay alive. So, Alonia going to the jungle, trying to say hello to Ophelia. Does a little bit of harassment, but in the end, going to go back to the lane and continue to beat out the creep wave. Tundra, though, as soon as she comes back into the lane, look at the burst damage again coming out from him with the cold shoulder and the piercing shards, and Alonia is forced to fall back. So great pressure once again put out by Tundra right there, as Alonia going to be forced to use the health potion. So some early aggression early on for both teams, but still 3.5 minutes in and no Bloodlust kill happening just yet.
Here's the problem for the Legion's team is that you're still getting decent farm on Pyro. I mean, he is 7-4. It's being hindered a little bit, but that's not too far from the 8-5 creep score that Flint has. And at the same time, you have a jungler, so you're utilizing the farm in the jungle. You have great matchups. Top is just pretty much getting dominated by Draconis. If you look at his CS, it's 14-10 compared to 5-2. That's expected, though. Mid, yeah, Tundra does amazingly well in mid. I mean, that's why this hero was so strong. Of course, he has the potential to gank as well. Actually, Ophelia might be in a little bit of trouble if he gets caught out here, but Alonia is just going to walk back towards the mid. Didn't get the rune, maybe just kind of wanted to concede that. But, yeah, I feel like they could have put a little bit more aggression on Ophelia right there. But the problem is, whenever you have a tri-lane against a jungling strat, you're always going to lose in the farm and experience department just simply because you're not managing or you're not utilizing as much farm as you could.
Yeah, I mean, what about that, though? Tomkiss here playing this Flint Beastwood. His farm isn't the greatest. I mean, for being a tri lane here at this bottom lane, all three range, or no, I guess not all three range, excuse me, Fade, of course, not being range, but it seems like that this is something that shouldn't be too difficult for Flint to be getting creep kills in. But I guess when the camp is blocked, of course, preventing you from taking advantage of that, and Ophelia being in the jungle, always keeping you timid, I'm sure. Maybe that's the reason for Flint Beastwood being so under. Do you think he's under farmed, or is this kind of where you would expect him to be?
Oh, this is where I expect him. And actually, Ophelia's getting gone on right here. The stun comes out from Fade. It's very low damage, though, because all her spells are only level 1. The stun actually comes out from the Minotaur while it is using, while the Ice Imprisonment is on him. But it should actually fall here. It's just standing here. It is only a level 1 Ice Imprisonment, so it doesn't do that much damage. But they're going to get credit for this Minotaur kill. But yeah, I expect Flint to be doing about as good as he is. They do have a tri lane down here, but it's a double range lane, and like you said, even though they have the ward down here to spot out the potential Ophelia ganks, you know, she can still maneuver her way around, say, like, below this cliff. And just, yeah, like you said, the threat and the presence of Ophelia nearby just kind of makes things a little bit more difficult. But Flint's actually doing quite a good job, but the problem is the other lanes are getting dominated. I mean, Tundra's doing a very, very good job at mid. Draconis completely owning his lane, and at the same time, you still have a jungler soaking up a bunch of farm in the jungle.
Yeah, it really is looking pretty good all across the board right now for the big boys. Again, though, 6 minutes in, still no Bloodlust kill. Now, that hasn't been because lack of action. We've definitely had a good amount of pressure being put out by both teams, but it just so happens no kills have happened to come out as a result of that yet. Alonia is going to go to the top lane. Unfortunately, yet again, she's going to be wrong on the rune spawn. Instead, Fade will pick up the haste on the bottom, so at least her team still gets it. Actually, the courier running into Fade right here, but you see the invulnerability coming out, and the courier will be more than fine. Fade is coming towards the middle lane, though, but obviously she was spotted, and she's still level 2 on top of that. So support Fade. I mean, we've seen it many times. Well, I don't want to say many times. We've seen it several times before. It's not like it's a rare thing, but from what I've heard about, at least, and I'm curious what you think as well, but she has great potential to be a support, but this is a downside, especially in a trial lane. She's still level 2.
Oh, mid.
On top of that, we do see in the mid lane. Bloodlust kill is going to come out right there. Alonia's taken out. Tundra going on. Of course, Ophelia with the assistance. And didn't even use a Minotaur stun, it seemed like. So just really a good amount of damage coming out from Tundra once again.
I mean, even just the Tundra before the Ophelia came in there with the final nuke did so much damage to Alonia, who is only sitting at 625 HP. Bottom lane, there's some aggression as well. It looks like Bubble's actually coming in, doesn't have the kelp field ready. A couple more auto attacks onto Aluna, but Aluna's going to be okay. They might be able to turn this actually on. Bubble does not have to take cover. Pyro's going to fall, though, as well. So it was a one-for-one exchange, but actually here's Aluna wants blood. The health potion's up on Fade. Tries to use the stun, but no, Aluna's just going to kind of sidestep that. But a one-for-one trade when your suicide hero has to go down there, even without the ultimate. So I kind of question the ability or the decision-making of coming down there without the ultimate. And as in the meantime, you know, Rookie playing that Draconis is soaking up so much farm, 46 CS, and it's actually putting a lot of pressure on this defense tower.
Yeah, well, that's exactly the first thing I noticed as well. Even during the fight, Bubbles wasn't level 6. He didn't have a kelp field. If he had a kelp field right there, that would have been completely different. They would have most likely gotten both of those kills, and, you know, it could have very likely all survived. But because he wasn't level 6 and chose to try to go in for a gank, it just didn't work out. Ophelia, in the meantime, Ophelia's going to be bursted down. So, again, we see a good amount of that burst damage coming out from Alonia right there. But in the meantime, you said it. Draconis was pressuring that top tower. And there we go. 8 minutes into the game, already has a tower kill, the top creep farm in the game with 50 now, 400 gold per minute already for Draconis. That is not good. Steam Boots, Ring of the Teacher, and Life Tube already purchased.
Yeah, the problem with the thinking of this tri lane in the bottom is, especially when you're up against a jungler, obviously I mentioned, when you're going up against a jungle strat and you're tri laning, you're going to lose out on a lot of farm and experience. So they had to get something done in this lane. Like, they had to get kills, and they just simply weren't getting those kills. And that's the problem that you know, the Legion team is in right now. And as a result, they're massively trailing early on. Don't get me wrong, it's early on, but 4K experience, 3,700 gold.
Yeah.
That's quite a lot, actually, at 8 minutes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's quite the deficit. And I think, again, yeah, it's a bigger picture, too. It's the biggest fact is that really Tundra, or not well, yeah, even Tundra, I guess. Tundra farming 325 gold per minute. He's already been a pretty solid impact. He's going to continue to be it throughout this game, of course, as he does. And then Draconis, though, he is just such a scary hero. I mean, he just inevitably will get that farm, but at the very least, you want to hold him off early on, at least kind of slow him down or take advantage elsewhere. But again, that just really isn't happening. You pull up the gold per minute chart. I mean, you look at this Legion side. Nothing's really standing out right now that's looking too good for Midget Mafia Reunion. So they're definitely already in a little bit of a hole here. 9.5 minutes in, we got Flint Beast, but he's farming 260 gold per minute. So obviously that's really the only thing right now. Ghost Marchers decided to go for him on top of the Ring of the Teacher. What do you make of Ghost Marchers? I mean, looking at Boots can be a little bit nitpicky and ultimately preference in the end, but to me it seems like Steam Boots, both for survivability and just attack speed on a hero like Flint Beast would, maybe more beneficial.
Yeah,
Ghost Marchers.
I like Steam Boots way more on Flint Beastwood. I think just as you get towards the late game too, it's just so much better. Maybe his thinking is just he wants to be mobile right now because they are in a huge rut. But I still think that overall Steam Boots are much better on Flint. Mid tower tier 1 is getting pressured. The TPs are coming out, so will he defend this? I don't know. Tundra's actually very deep in there. Dirty Maw is discredited for the kill. There's the Kelp Field coming out onto Pyromancer. He's in a lot of trouble. He gets his stun off and as well as his ulti. So good job by him. Fade's going to go down as well. Holy cow, getting double tap. Tundra is getting pursued. He will fall to Hicks, actually, gets the last hit. But here's Draconis. He wants some blood. He's going to actually get Ice Imprisoned by Glacius. And Alonia's running away. He's in retreat mode as well as Flint Beastwood. So what is that? We got, what, a 3-for-2? No, a 2-for-2. Trade there, but they did get the middle tower. So.
Yeah, it was an attempt to be denied, but just a little bit too quick right there for the Hellborn team, and the big boys do indeed get the tower kill. So with that, you know, ultimately that's definitely what gave them the win there, I think, in that little skirmish that happened in the middle lane. But Alonia is showing good burst damage. Every single time we see her kind of get involved in a fight, the heroes just seem to drop when her abilities come out. So this is definitely a hero with burst potential, it seems like. I mean, pulling up the damage chart. Now, of course, that could be a little bit skewed because she's obviously was harassing a lot early on with that Q ability of hers, the what is that called? The Glacial Spike ability. But still, again, it's an idea of really what she brings to the table. But overall, again, Midget Mafia Reunion, our Legion team over here, they are no doubt in a very difficult spot. You see Ophelia going to continue to farm, picking over another Skeleton King. You mentioned those were actually buffed in the most recent balance patch, at least. Fade actually going to try to run into Ophelia right here, but Ophelia is just a little bit too quick. Now the minions are going to be taken out. It looks like Catman Champion falls. The two Skeleton Kings, actually, though, with their 1,400 life, they're going to be able to survive in the end. But at least some positive news again there coming out for our Legion side. But Tomkiss here on Flint Beastwood, now he's 275 GPM. He is 0-0-3, so, and it does actually go a Mighty Blade here. So would you like to see a Shrunken Head here, or is that possibly could be an Ice Brand? I mean, what do you think?
I don't think you can go Shrunken Head here. I mean, yeah, they do have a lot of magic damage, but if you want to be able to contest this dragon in the late game, you're going to have to get some kind of farming tool. And you're going to have to play extremely passively this entire game. You're going to have to just farm, and hope for the best. Actually, they do take out Luna, but she is only level 5, or actually she just being 6 before that. So Tomkiss, good pickup kill right there. But this is what I'm talking about. Okay, Ophelia, she's got to be pretty close to level 8, and you got to compare her as a jungler to another support. That's basically what jungling is, and that's why it's so strong, is to compare it. It's a support that gets lots of farm, can still have the ability to gank, and gets a lot of experience as well. And she's just doing so much more for her team right now than, say, Fade. Yeah, and the problem with this dry lane, as I mentioned, it needed to get kills. And I feel like Fade's stun is very effective. It's very strong. But if they had a hero that had more of a long-range spell, something like Behemoth, I think that's a little bit better.
Oh, Pyromancer going to take it out of Alonia with the Haste Rune, though. Should be able to get away. In the meantime, Bubbles will fall, so it ends up being a one-for-one exchange. That was good response, though, coming up from the Hellborn team for the most part. Alonia actually missed her initial nuke on a Pyromancer. She did a good job sidestepping there. But in the end, just too much damage again, especially I think it's the Flash Freeze ability that seems to be doing so much damage here for Alonia. So it ends up, like I said, being a one-for-one exchange. Bubbles in that suicide roll, not having the prettiest of starts, but that happens with Bubbles. At least he is level 8, which isn't too bad considering the circumstances, but it is falling behind. So like you were kind of saying, comparing Flint to that Draconis especially, Flint is pushing the bottom lane in the meantime with Glacius actually going to use that Q of his, the Explosive Flare, to actually do some damage on the defensive tower, but now it's going to start to fall back and continue to farm some more. But again, we'll see what route Tomkiss here decides to go for with that Mighty Blade pickup. So to answer as a whole, just to bring this up again, you see Rookie asking the question there. It is a European server, apparently, this game. This is a US East versus European matchup. So how it works, the automatic system, it finds the best server. And if it's this kind of matchup, I believe it'll go Europe 1, US East next, and then random to third. So just to clarify on that.
Okay.
For those that are wondering, again, that has to do with the old automated system here with the Haunt Tour event. So, Nullstone just finished, though, on Draconis.
Yeah.
We only hit the 14-minute mark. It seems like we say it a lot, but yet again, another case here. Draconis is just a farming freaking machine. Bottom lane, though, we could have some action picking up. Oh, this could be very interesting action. This is a big chance here for the Legion team. They have the numbers advantage. Can they initiate appropriately? Fade coming in with the invis. Can he line up a Burning Shadow Stun? Bebbles, will he shell survey? No, he will not. He chooses not to pour. There's the open for Fade, though. The Money Shot going to come out onto Luna. No, it's not going to happen, though. Alonia with a burst damage. Now, Pyromancer will fall, as does Ophelia. Aluna's going to be caught out. You see Tundra off to the side. Nothing that he's going to be able to do, though. And the Legion team just decimates that fight right there.
Yeah, I mean, that burst potential from Alonia is pretty crazy, but they simply just didn't have the numbers. I mean, they were pushing there. They really had no place of pushing. Draconis wasn't there. He's top now. And they simply had no place of pushing that right now. They also have lacking vision. And I got to mention, too, that Hicks right down here in the bottom river, or sorry, I should say close to the bottom river, has had the same ward up pretty much the entire game. They really like this ward, apparently. But it's giving them good vision. And Hellborn just had no place in fighting that without the vision. And Tomkiss gets credit for the kill right there, the tower kill.
You could see that coming the whole way. And like I said, they had the numbers advantage going into it. And again, I always go back to this because it's true. We have the god vision. We have the spectator vision.
Yep.
So it's a lot easier for us to tell. But at the same time, if you can't see that, if you don't have that information, you really shouldn't be pushing yourself with only three people there. I mean, I guess they kind of had four. Tundra was kind of there, but he wasn't even really. So, that was just, at the same time, though, well played by our Legion team. And no doubt, putting them right back into this game where it seemed like things were maybe starting to pull away more and more, but that's definitely helping them. I mean, Flint Beastwood, he's 2-0-5, man. Flint Beastwood is being involved in this game when it comes to hero kills. He has 2,400 gold. He's back to base right now, so we're going to get an idea of what he wants to go for here. If he goes Icebrand, no, he's actually going to purchase a Firebrand. So he just goes straight into the Firebrand after picking up the Mighty Blade. Just wanted the Mighty Blade for the initial health boost. May eventually turn into that into a Frostburn. Wouldn't be surprised.
Yep.
And then... well, he'll go from there, but ports back to the bottom lane and going to continue to farm, so good item pick up there.
It seems to be the European build. I remember when Flint was played all the time, there was a number of varying options. So you could actually, Draconis doing a lot of damage, but Alonia's doing a lot of damage herself, being only level 11, so Draconis did have that haste rune, so he's going to run away. But yeah, there seemed to be a lot of varying builds onto Flint Beastwood, but it seemed like the European-style build was Ghost Marchers into Frostburn. I saw it pretty much every single game, so I expect that to be the same here.
Yeah, wouldn't be surprised. So, again, I'm kind of looking at Alonia, and we're learning with everyone else, I'm sure, here. I mean, the first time we've actually seen her, at least on Honkast. The Absolute Zero, her ultimate, that could definitely do a lot of damage. What's the cooldown? It seems like it's fairly low. 80 second cooldown at level 11, actually. All the way down to a minute at level 3. Bottom lane, we do see a Luna going down right there. Sorry, I missed the action, but I'm sure it was just Fade and Flint Beastwood comboing together, and Aluna being the support hero that she is. Not too many items, in fact, only boots and a power supply, really, so easily got dropped right there. How about Fade? I mean, Elgo here. Elgo? Anyways, Fade here. He's level 8. I mean, he got off to a pretty slow start, but he's 0-1-7 now, so he has 7 assists out of the 10 kills total. Again, he's been involved. It really seems like the Legion team has kind of at least slowed this game down enough and started to take control of the pace a little bit here as it's progressed. Now, with that said, you still have a Draconis that's farming 517 gold per minute. So, by all means, Baltimore team still has some good things going for them. In fact, they're going to catch Flint Beastwood down here. Oh my god, the burst damage is way too intense. Pyromancer Tundra and Draconis, they get a payback kill right there. And Tomkiss takes his first death of the game, actually.
Yeah, and actually, holy cow, with that freshly purchased portal key, maybe caught him off guard. And I mean, that's the problem with Flint, is he can contest in the late game with all these hard carries. It's just the problem is getting him there. Doesn't farm as quickly as Draconis, obviously. I mean, he's had a great start. Before that death, he was 3-0-5. But he was only sitting at 340 gold per minute. Draconis, 1-0-1, 530. It's just the ability to farm stacks and your lane presence as well. Yeah, he can contend in the late game, but it's just a matter of getting there.
Yeah. We have a poke to pause coming out here from the Legion side. Hopefully, cross your fingers. Nothing too serious, but obviously a big kill right there, because not only did they kill the carry of the Legion team, but it also really opened up the opportunity to easily push that bottom tower. So quite a swing right there in favor of the big boys, and they may actually just keep going for this. You see the minimap right now, as we're sitting in the pause. Glacius and Bubbles currently at the top lane, and Fade as well as Alonia, are in the middle lane, pushing that tower. Now, everyone does have Homecoming Stone? No, they don't, actually. Glacius does not, and Bubbles' Homecoming Stone is on cooldown, actually. So this should be a free tower kill for the Hellborn team. I don't think the Legion team, there's any chance of them stopping this, and honestly, with the circumstances, it seems like it'd be kind of silly for them to even try. So, this could be a free tower kill coming up for the Hellborn team. We do have a timeout for Fade. Again, hopefully nothing too serious.
Yeah, I think their thinking is, well, we can't really fight them heads up right now with all their pushing power, with Draconis being as farmed as he is. So let's try to counter push. The only problem is this: the tier 1 tower in both mid and top have taken very little damage. They're close to full HP, and Bubbles and Glacius are not exactly, you know, you're pushing heroes, and they're not going to really push it that quickly.
Yeah.
Now, Bubbles' TP, as you mentioned, is on cooldown for a long time, actually 20 seconds. Glacius can't pick one up, but they can't fight without Bubbles, and with that TP being on cooldown, they just simply are going to have to concede that tower.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this is it's already looking at a 6,600 gold lead as well as a 6,000 experience lead right now for the Hellborn team. It's going to get even bigger, of course, for them. So we do have, it looks like, the Hellborn team. They're just waiting on one more thing. Then we should be good to go here in what is game number one. If you do just happen to be tuning in to Honkast.com, of course, we are here starting our coverage for the day for our Hon Tour qualifiers, continuing this weekend, starting with a loser's bracket matchup. And this is a best set of three, as it is all the way through. So on that note, one of these teams, unfortunately, their qualifier run will be over, and they will be headed to the bronze division, where the winning team, they'll keep their hopes alive of fun. Further advancing, and of course even competing for a bit of that $10,000 prize pool. So yeah, that's kind of just a quick recap there. This is, again, game number one, as you can see on the scoreboard at the top. But as expected, this bottom tower heavily pressured. And yeah, if you're Flint Beastwood, I understand maybe a little bit of harassment, but you want to be careful not to get caught out at the same time, because you know Tundra has that portal key now. They're somewhat committing to a defense here. Okay, this could be dangerous. No, they are going to get the tower kill. You see Flint Beastwood taking the Skeleton King net right there. Will be fine. Meanwhile, at the top lane, actually, Bobble's going to get caught out. Tundra to port in. He's going to try to homecoming. No, Dragonfire Stone. No, not in time. Pyromancer even canceling at the last second, and Bubbles will survive. So the good news there for the Legion team is that he lives, but they did lose a tower.
Yeah, is that he lives, eh? yeah, they're going to lose that tower. Actually, it is deniable. I don't know if they know that. Maybe they're just one of the things I like to do, actually, is just if you have your glyph up. I don't know if it was popped there.
Not sure.
But if you do have your glyph up, just keep the tower there. You can even bait something if they try to get a tower kill. If not even that, you just have the ability to TP there and have more map control.
Yeah.
So a lot of times I see people just deny, but sometimes you don't really have to. Just keep it there. They're obviously not pushing anytime soon. Like, they don't have the largest pushing lineup. They actually have good anti-push with Bubbles and Alonia, but yeah, they can't really push that hard. So just keep the tower there.
Yeah. Now, let's take a look at the items, actually. I haven't mentioned too much about that overall. Actually, Draconis here in the middle lane, going to get caught with the gun for Luna with the burst damage on follow. There we go. The ultimate's going to be his. Look at Draconis dropping right there. He's trying to run away. Not going to happen, though. He tried a Blazing Flight, but Alonia locking him in place with the assistance of everyone else. And again, we got the idea of that absolute zero ability, as it's called, her ultimate. The damage that can do on a target that, you know, has trouble getting away as a result of her abilities, really, let alone the team being there. So you got to question a little bit at the same time, though. What was Draconis doing by himself that far pushed up? I mean, there was a good 5-6 second window there for support to come in, and they never did. So Draconis perhaps just getting a little bit overzealous himself, well, and unfortunately overstepping his boundaries.
I honestly think that was one of those cases of, I don't really know what Alonia does, but holy crap, I didn't know it did that much damage. I literally think that's what happened.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, you know, he saw Alonia, he's like, oh, no big deal, but yeah, it was just a matter of, oh my god, it really does that much damage? Okay, well, I'll know for next time. And I think the Shrunken Head is actually, if not up, he's gotten about 400 gold, because I see that Warhammer on the courier.
Yeah. God, I mean, that ultimate has potential, apparently, to do 625 magic damage AoE. We do see Pyromancer at the top, and the Cole missing, actually! Pyromancer turning around the Dragonfire! That was really maybe his only chance, so he figured he'd give it a shot, and he eventually falls right there. Glacius apparently complaining about some latency issues. I'm going to go ahead and do a ping all myself, and looks like, for now, it's at 235, so this is a European server, right? Yeah, it is, actually. And I know Corsix is a European, so that seems like it is a little bit high for her. Unfortunate there. South Korea, hey? All the way from South Korea, apparently. Yeah, so, again, I'm sure they'll pause, though, if it becomes too much of an issue here to deal with. But anyways, there you go with the Shrunken Head finish, as you were just talking about.
Yep.
On Draconis. So he's got that Shrunken Head.
Shrunken Hone!
Kind of mixed the Nullstone in there. Shrunken Head, Nullstone combination. And he is, he's set in that sense. Again, though, I'm looking at this Flint Beastwood. He could have had the Frostburn by now if he really wanted that. So it leads me to believe that he is going to be going for Shrunken Head here.
Okay.
So we'll see.
So he just wanted to use that Firebrand as a farming tool. I've seen that done a number of times. Firebrand actually is a very, very good item in itself. Because, wants to go the Geometer's Bane route. Okay. So he's just basically picking up that Mighty Blade for a little bit more stats early on. And that's a very standard thing to do as well.
Yeah.
It looks like we are going to have a pause here, maybe to fix some lag issues. As, yeah, actually, I did ping all, and Hicks was pinging 999, so probably having some own personal issues with the internet.
Yeah. It is Glacius, let's be honest. Just sits there with Yara.
Yeah, exactly. Come on now.
What happened to those days, Trelf, where Glacius literally was just a mana battery, where he just maxed out Aura? I still remember that. That's how Glacius used to be played for the longest time. And then there was players like Yoda is a player that comes to mind, who initially started to build a more like the Tundra Blast, Ice Imprisonment aggressive build, and that seemed to become the norm then, with just the one into the Aura.
Well, the reason why is Glacius found a way in the competitive scene as, you know, being one of the strongest laning supports. People realize you can initiate from far away with those Glacial Blasts. And for that reason, you want to be able to level up those skills to actually do damage. And I feel like the first team that would really start first picking Glacius all the time and using him frequently and actually brought him into the scene, really, or back into the scene, I should say, was Reason Gaming. Was first picking Glacius for a long time, and I remember we'd always kind of like laugh at them.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, why are you first picking Glacius? What a can't believe
what
this
a dumb
Reason
pick.
Team.
Yeah.
But then it started to catch on. Like, oh, wow. The thing after that was Pebbles Glacius. That was the lane for a long time as kind of the standard mid lane is, oh, my God, we can initiate from very far away. And, oh, my God, look how much damage we're doing. And that's when people started to realize, okay, Glacius, let's get rid of this aura and just do lots of damage with this hero that's laning so properly.
Yeah, recent gaming definitely had an impact on the competitive scene. I mean, they were in it for a while. Of course, they were a runner-up at a DreamHack event. I think that was DreamHack Summer 2010, I want to say. I'm not exactly sure, maybe 2011, but... they're runner up to Fnatic MSI there. And the funny thing about that, so you mentioned the whole Glacius thing with them. Wild Soul is actually another hero that, specifically Yiftig, as pronounced it, for recent gaming. He's kind of that one that really brought Wild Soul on the competitive scene, and they were very successful running him. So,
yeah.
And not to say that that was the reason why he's played by any means, but they were a team that was known to run the good old Wild Soul. So. Always fun. It's kind of funny to bring that up, too, because actually there's a post on Reddit right now. Shout out to the Han Reddit community. There's a post on the Reddit where it's talking about nostalgia, basically, with Heroes of New Earth and going back through, like, all these hero changes and old-school heroes and what abilities used to be for them and just, like, the meta games and whatnot. So it's a lot of fun to read. You should definitely check it out if when you have some time here. So.
Yeah, Wild Soul has definitely evolved a bit. We've seen him played a long time ago in the short lane. And built more like the just on the items on the hero, not the bear.
Yeah.
And then we've seen him for a long time just jungled, but right now I think people are realizing, you know, the potential of, you know, in lockpick, it's all about getting a strong suicide, in my opinion. And obviously Wild Soul is one of the strongest, if not the strongest suicide hero, because of the ability to pull those creeps constantly and be at a safe spot to farm those creeps over and over. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so we've seen evolution of certain heroes, and actually as a couple heroes, or no, not heroes, but players have timed out, so hopefully they're able to fix their issues quickly and get back with the game.
Yeah, that would be fun, of course. Again, this is game number one here in a best out of three between Midget Mafia Reunion taking on the big boys. Again, I swear to God, this was 100% random. I was literally, just as always, especially with these losers bracket matches, you kind of have to go through and make sure that the teams, they are planning to have five there and everything, so kind of just going down the bracket and just so happened to get in contact with these two captains, and before I even realized, I mean, again, there's a couple players that happened to be, especially on this Legion side, that I even recognized, so that was kind of cool to see. And so far, we're getting a decent matchup here. Obviously, the Hellborn side, the big boys, they've had momentum for most of this game. They definitely had a slight advantage of that, but our Legion team, you know, they've been hanging in there at least, 22 and a half minutes in. Draconis, though, man, with that Shrunken and Nullstone, of course, on his way to whatever his next item is. Usually at this point, something like that Geometer's Bane, the Whispering Helm, the Savage Mace, just depending on what they feel like, it seems like it's going to be next in line for him. So,
yeah, and the thing is, you know, despite the Legion side actually being ahead quite heavily in creep kill, or sorry, in hero kills, it is 12-6 in favor of them, but they are trailing by a significant amount in golden experience. And the thing is, you kind of are, with this lineup on the Hellborn, kind of dumping all your eggs in the Tundra, or not the Tundra, but the Draconis basket.
Yeah.
But I feel like he can actually do that this game. Like, I feel like he actually could 1v5 their team with items up, like you mentioned. Because he's simply going to farm them so much faster than Flint is going to farm. And, Flint, like I said, he's very strong in the late game, but you're going to need items like Shrunken Head, Geometer's Bane, Symbol of Rage, Savage Mace after that, and then maybe a Wingbow after that. You're going to need full items to be able to maybe contest with Draconis. But I just don't know if he's going to have that opportunity at the rate that Draconis is farming.
Yeah. Yeah, it is a big question mark right now for the Legion side. Again, Tom Kiss, a.k.a. Russ Agent 007, just to keep reiterating that. The one playing Flint Beast with this game for Midget Mafia Reunion. I keep going back to the damage chart occasionally. I've been checking that more and more lately on these casts, been trying to. And again, Alonia still up there. Nearly a quarter of the hero damage done this game, when you think about it, has been by Alonia. Again, we're still fairly early on, and I know, obviously, in the laning phase, a good amount of harassment coming out, but still. We've seen some good burst damage potential, so the first time at least seeing Alonia on Honkast, it seems like her debut's going off pretty well so far, and I'm intrigued to see how she advances, of course, on this game. I mean, she got the Tablet of Command, so speaking of item pickups, a Steam Boost and a Tablet into Grave Locket, so, of course, a solid start for her. Obviously, has that bottle currently, a Haste Rune bottled up, even. Another 2,100 gold saved up, though. Is this a hero you think Portal Key could be a possibility on, or?
I honestly don't know. I mean, you already have kind of a getaway item with that Tablet of Command. Maybe something just like a Hellflower or Sheepstick.
Yeah.
I think Sheepseek might be very good here. The only problem is you are dealing with a Draconis that does have a Null Stone, but you do have a number of different ways to cancel that. Obviously, you can use the long range from Flint to do that. Now, Flint, the ult does do a lot of damage, but in pushing, you just want a long range spell that's just going to get rid of that Null Stone so you can jump the Draconis before they use that Shrunken Head.
Right as they see it ready, unfortunately, Fade times out again. So,
oh, man.
They're going to have to go to and pause it another time, and hopefully. he's able to reconnect and again get this figured out. The last thing we'd want is for this to be delayed even further because of that. So hopefully the internet issue gets figured out and then the game can move on. But yeah, so with 2130 gold saved up for Alonia, interested to see where she goes next. I think you're right, though. It seems like something more like the Hellflower or the Sheepstick is very possible going to be that choice. Now, I was also going through her abilities to make sure. It seems like her... Oh, wait, her W is a... I don't know why I thought her W was not an ability. Okay, so they're all three abilities, so she gets charges just from using the ability. It's not like a passive. Okay, interesting. Anyways, I know her E is a single target, so I believe the W and the Q, though, are in target position. So, yeah, they're not... They cannot deactivate the Null Stone. That's where I'm getting at, though. So if she wanted to deactivate the Null Stone, she could actually do it herself with the Flash Freeze ability. With that E of hers, which is on only a 15-second cooldown, so not necessarily the biggest deal in the world. But, of course, you do have Glacius as well. So, not too many options, though, when you actually think about it over here on the Legion side. And even Money Shot from Flint Peace to it, but usually you don't want to deactivate Null Stones with that ability, so...
Well, I think it's actually appropriate in pushes, because you just simply need a long... Like, if you're wanting to initiate a team fight properly, you're going to have to go into Draconis. And the only way to do that is to cancel this Null Stone first. And the only contender right now for a long-range Null Stone canceler is Flint Beastwood, unless you jump in there, like you mentioned, with a portal key on, like, say, Alonia, and then push booked. But I don't really think that's the route that they need to go.
I didn't realize that was so long, or such a short cooldown. And so long. Right now it's 2,000 range with a 15-second cooldown.
Yeah, it's pretty short.
That is ridiculous.
And I think it even goes lower. Yeah, it goes to 10 seconds.
Yeah, it goes 10 seconds and 2,500 range. Now, it is it's a pretty high mana cost, actually, for an agility hero, especially. It's 275 right now, all the way to 375 at next level, so definitely adds up in the levels. But with only the Q, of course, the Explosive Flare being the other mana cost ability. Not the biggest deal in the world.
Yep, not the biggest deal. But other thing to mention about is the Fade being played by Elgo. Unfortunately, he's having some net issues, but... you know, Fade's a very strong hero, and you mentioned he's actually recovered nicely after having a kind of slow start in that trialing as expected because you're losing out a lot of experience and farm, but has recovered nicely. Now, the only thing is Tundra is a very, very good counter to Fade, if there is any counter to Fade, is because you have that bird to spot out throughout the trees. You know, obviously Fade likes to maneuver with that clear vision and that unit walking through the trees, but with the Tundra Hawk above him, and having said Bound Eye is actually on a Luna Alonia. Now I'm screwing it up. but if a Luna gives that Bound Eye to Tundra, it's going to be easy to spot out that Fade.
Yeah.
And it is only a level 1 ulti, so that ulti from Fade is very low. It's only 20 seconds.
Exactly. Yeah, that's something else I was going to bring up, too. So Fade is no doubt in a tough spot with that said. That on top of, well, just being lagged out, of course. That's not always too fun. So apparently he is going to be coming back here, though. And again, cross our fingers that... does not have an issue again. Energizer was actually just purchased on Ophelia very recently, so while we're on the topic of, well, sitting in a pause here, non-item, so Energizer on her with the Astrolabe as well as a Plated Greaves, so going very team-heavy, you can say, as Ophelia players tend to do. Of course, even with the Ring of the Teacher on top of that, so. But yeah, Energizer pickup, you know, why the hell not? Energizer definitely brings something to the table, especially ever since that change happened. It seems like it is an item that we have started to see more and more now on the competitive scene, at least. So, is connecting back in. Once it's 100%, hopefully we'll get the ready ups and it'd be good to go here. Ophelia currently has it's one Catman, a Vulture Lord, and a Skeleton King. We'll see if they make some kind of push. They are somewhat here in the middle lane, but maybe look like they might do some Ancients as well. Draconis is level 16, though, so he does have that level 3 Cataclysmic Assault.
And that's such a low cooldown, too, in itself. 30 seconds, and it lasts 8. So basically a 22-second cooldown. That's pretty crazy. And we've seen that just do a lot of damage. Of course, the Legion team being as squishy as they are right now at this moment, it's going to be very devastating. It looks like Fade finally is back, so we're ready to go.
Yeah. Very good manners here on the Legion side. Between the both teams, I will say that. Of course, being patient here and saying they're sorry, even though, you know, internet issues happen. It sucks. Shit happens. Game moves on, though. So here we go. It looks like things are going to go down, and the game will resume. So we got Flip Eastwood pushing them top lane here by himself. He is on his way to apparently finishing a Geometer's Bane. But yeah, here we go for Kongor, actually. So the big boys want to meet with the big Kongor here. Back to... Oh, wait, it still says it's Franken Kongor, but it looks like it's regular Kongor to me now.
Yeah. Wait, it says it's Franken?
I found a bug.
Oh.
That's funny. I'm sure that's meant to be changed. No more Halloween patch. That is unfortunate. Anyways, top tower went down for the Legion team, but Kongor will fall here in favor of the big boys, it looks like.
The biggest boy is now going to fall, and that token of life probably going to go in that Draconis.
Yeah, there's a lag. I'm actually feeling that too myself.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's some server lag, apparently. Yeah, a couple people are like at 100
well,
at zero even. So.
Let's not ever use EU82 again. Oh, and oh
times
my
that
God.
Again.
I don't know if that's the server though. I feel like that just might be his own internet.
Yeah. No. It's looking like he's just like screw this. We'll just move on without him. Do they really want to make it a 4v5?
Wow.
Okay. That just happened.
I think maybe a little frustrated.
Yeah. Wouldn't that be great? One for one. We'll kick our support fade for our hard carry Draconis. Seems fair, right? Oh, God. How amazing would that be?
Stupid Draconis farm all game.
All right. Well, okay. I never really seen a them team kick their own player before to solve an issue like this, but hey.
Yeah.
To each their own, right? You know, it's I guess it's like you said, out of just frustration. They just want to keep the match going, so yeah. We're gonna go ahead and resume here. It's now a 4v5, and well, things just got a lot more difficult for our Legion team if they weren't already.
Now I mentioned the Tundra is a great counter to Fade, but oh man, trying to initiate these fights now without Fade in the background, trying to pick someone off with that ulti, it's gonna be near impossible. You do have the Geometer's Bane up on Flint, but like I said, he's gonna need full item to contest this Draconis who's sitting at 520 gold per minute.
Yeah. Yeah, it really puts him in a tough spot now. So, it also is the case now, if you're the big boys, it's not your fault that he lagged out. You know, it was obviously the Legion's team to kick him in the first place. So, but if I'm the big boys, I'm saying, you know what, it's a 5v4. There's no way we should be losing these fights. We're already ahead. It would have already been, you know, a good time for us initially. But now with it being 5v4, let's go ahead and take advantage of it. And that's exactly what they're doing right here. And obviously that makes sense. You know, they're going to group up here at the bottom lane. They're going to push us 5. And no matter what, they'll have the numbers advantage because of, well, just where the game stands. So we might see an attempt right here by the Legion team, but it's going to be very difficult to stop. I don't know if you're getting the lag
I am.
Yeah, I don't know if that's maybe it's just
terrible
us
server.
And it's just server overall. It seems like they were complaining themselves. So, yeah, the server's starting to act up, unfortunately. But
EU82, take note.
Yes,
I have to mention that there have actually been some servers that just happen to do that for whatever reason. But usually, if you make a note of that and try to tell somebody.
Oh, yeah.
They can
make a note of it, you know, send it into I believe you can send it to support at s2games.com and they are very good at looking into that. You know,
they
people complain a lot of the time. You know, it happens. Again, it's technical issues, it happens, but the last thing you should report it. I mean, it's just simple as, again, just sending a quick email, telling them what the server was and just letting them know, cuz it you know, it's easy to say or complain, but if they're not aware of the issue, then, you know, there's only so much they can actually do, obviously. So if there are issues like this, we're saying we'll go ahead and let the crew know and go from there. But we do see Bubbles jumping in. Alonia's going to follow it up with the Flash Freeze on top. And Tundra's dropping pretty fast. But there's the Golden Dragon with the Cataclysmic Assault. And the Legion team is melting apart. Alonia in the background. They got Tundra killed. But she dies shortly after. Flint Beastwood buys back. He ports in, but right on top of Draconis. And Draconis will gladly take that with the Blazing Flight activated. Flint Beastwood running back to base already. Already at half life. This tower is going to fall. The racks are next in line. And we see the Legion team. In fact, they're already going to call GD well played. Yeah, it clearly got to a point there where, unfortunately, lag got the best of them. The server started to act up a little bit. But the Elborn team, they were in a solid lead. It is unfortunate, though, that we didn't get to see the game maybe played out a little bit better there. But in the end, the big boys, they were in control for really all of that game when you look back at it, and definitely deserving of that victory there.
Yeah, they tried for an all-in right there. I mean, Alonia purchased a Shrunken Head, had double Grave Locket, by the way. Actually did so much damage, so it's unfortunate that we didn't get to see like a real game because of the unfortunate server issues. Now, you did mention Draconis was farming out of his mind. They were in a great spot. They had Kongor killed. They were looking to make a push anyway, I feel like. And there's very little to do also when you're grouping up as five pushing against a Fade. That's probably the best way to counter a Fade, is to group up and push and find lineups that can do that. And they definitely had that with Draconis and, of course, Tundra giving the vision and Ophelia having all those creeps.
Yeah, they did. And the big boys, like you said, recognize a couple of their players at least from some higher-level TMM. It's good to see them doing well here in the Haunteer event. Obviously, they got knocked down here, like I said, to Vitriolic, which is by no means a team to really scoff at. Definitely a solid team themselves. But here they are in the loser's bracket. Happens to run into a Midget Mafia reunion. And, well, they take game number one here. So congratulations to them. It is a best out of three, though. So, of course, that means game number two is going to be coming up here shortly. So sit tight, guys. Stay tuned. We're going to be coming back at you. Game number two just around the corner.